Hello, welcome along to the Fun Kids Science Weekly. My name is Dan. Thank you so much for listening. I'm delighted to announce, by the way, that this is officially the greatest podcast in the universe. Yeah, there was a podcast awards actually that happened on Neptune. Did you not hear about it? Yeah, I didn't manage to make it up in time, but I Zoom called in and it was worth it because we won the award. So that's what you're listening to here, which is great because we are uncovering all the true secrets of the universe as we always do. This week, you can take a look at one of the most fearsome birds in the sky. Also, we'll chat to an expert about a brand new book that talks about the circle of life. And you might get your questions answered. As always, today I'm answering them on balloons, on breathing, and on allergies. That's happening in just a sec. First, let's catch up with one of our favourite geniuses on the show. This is Karina and her superhero alter ego. It's K-Mystery.
K-Mystery. Elements in danger.
Hey, gang. K-Mystery here. Ready to take you on a journey to find out a little more about some of our elements in danger.
Hello? You're starting without me now. Whose chemistry superhero alter ego are you?
Well, there's no time to lose. We need to act now, or some of our most useful elements just won't be around anymore. And because we need them for our gadgets, that means your phones won't work.
Serious? So, what's up?
I need to introduce you to Incredible Indium.
Indium? Hey, I'm getting the hang of these. It's called indium because it was found in India. I'm right, aren't I? This is basic.
Wrong! Although, good guess. Elements are frequently named after the places or the people who found them, but indium gets its name because under certain conditions, it emits an indigo light. That's like a purpley-blue colour. Here, check it out.
Looks pretty silvery to me. What makes it different to other metals?
Not all metals are the same. Indium is in a group with other metals like tin and lead, and also gallium, another element in danger. They're what we call post-transition metals, which means, well, a whole bunch of things. They can be really soft and break easily, which isn't always a bad thing. Come on, hold tight. We're going to find out more. It all started here. Frederick Reich and Theodor Richter discovered indium in Germany in 1863.
Schauen Sie mal.
They look happy.
They should be. Indium is never found on its own. It's squished up with other metals like zinc. Over time, as technology became more and more clever, indium turned out to be super useful, particularly to help electronic gadgets emit light so we can see what's on the screens.
Yeah, they'd have to wait a bit for that. I'm guessing no phones in 1863.
Indium has a pretty weird trick up its sleeve. If you bend it, it makes a noise known as a tin scream. Although, to be honest, in real life it sounds more like this.
Disappointing.
What is disappointing is that it's so rare to get indium on its own and not mixed up with other things.
Like zinc.
Hey, you were listening. But as indium is very hard to extract, it's another element that we might not be able to use in 100 years' time.
I guess that's not very long. So, what are we going to do?
There's plenty you can do. More gadgets mean more elements are needed. So, simply buying fewer phones and tablets, well, we can start preserving the resources that we have, sharing and reusing technology you don't need anymore, and recycling them when they're broken. Some of these rare elements can be recovered and used again.
So you're saying if I help out, I'm kind of being a chemistry superhero too, just like you?
No one's just like me, Karina, but you'll be the next best thing.
Thanks, K-Mystery.
K-Mystery, Elements in Danger, with support from the Royal Society of Chemistry. Find out more and get hands-on with chemistry at funkidslive.com/chemistry.
Right, it's time for my favourite part of the show. I reckon it must be one of yours as well. It's where I answer the questions that you have left for me as a review over on Apple Podcasts. Talia has done that. She says, now back in July, her dad accidentally let a balloon that was filled with helium float high and it drifted all the way to the ceiling. And now 2 months later, it's still there. But why hasn't it come down? That's what she's asking. Well, there are lots of reasons why balloons go up and don't come down. It might be that a helium balloon, the one that your dad let float to the top of the ceiling, it might be that what makes it up is quite strong. It might be quite a tight structure, so no air is managing to slip out. But when you see a normal balloon that's drifted down towards the ground, maybe the oxygen and the nitrogen that's in there is sneaking away, which is making it deflate. Now, the reason that the balloon is staying up there, generally, the reason why helium balloons float much better is because helium is a much lighter gas than the nitrogen, the oxygen, the CO2 that makes up the air. So it floats high, and that's why it stays there. Our next question comes from the superbly named FatRat567, who wants to know, how does breathing work? Why doesn't the air that goes in just go straight back out again? Well, when we breathe in, Fat Rat, can I call you Fat Rat? Good. When we breathe in, we take in a lot of air and there's a mix of different stuff in there. Now, we need the oxygen, but we don't really need the rest. But there's a lot of nitrogen in there. There's a lot of other gases like carbon dioxide. There's all of that in there too. Now, some of that oxygen, when we breathe it into our lungs, goes from there into our blood and then it travels around the body. And it keeps us living. It feeds all of the organs, pretty much. But all of the stuff that isn't oxygen, which is most of it, we don't need. So we breathe it out. And remember, when we breathe, when we move, us humans, we make carbon dioxide, the gas. So our blood has to get that out somewhere. So it brings it back to the lungs and we breathe it out too. There you go, FatRat567. And the equally brilliant named... Now, the last question today is from Ethan Emmanuel, who is from Fort Lauderdale over in Florida in the States. Hey, Ethan, who asks, why do some people have allergies? Now, the simple answer to this is that an allergic reaction is what happens when your immune system reacts to something from the outside world, maybe pollen or venom or different types of food. Now, your immune system makes antibodies. And these help fight bacteria and viruses inside your body. Now, your immune system gets confused, really. It mistakenly identifies what you're allergic to as something that's harmful to you, even though it isn't really. And the sniffing and the swelling or every different type of reaction that you get is because your antibodies are kind of attacking your own body because they're confused by this strange thing that you've eaten or breathed in. Now, why we get allergies can sometimes be quite strange. Get this, some scientists think that it's due to a really old reaction to parasitic worms. Now, ages ago, before modern health and safety, parasitic worms found it quite easy to get into our bodies and do us some damage. So some scientists think that our reaction to those is what's causing the allergic reactions that you get today. There you go, quite a simple answer, but it's a very complex question. Thank you very much for it, Ethan Emmanuel. If you've got a question just like those that you want answered on the show, you need to get yourself to Apple Podcasts and leave us a review over there. You're listening to the Fun Kids Science Weekly. Now, this week's guest is a friend of the show. She's been on before. She's a science writer. You might remember she spoke to us earlier on this year, I think, all about a book about the climate that she wrote. Her name is Isabel Thomas. She's got a brand new one out now. It's called, it's all about the circle of life. It's called Fox. Isabel, thank you for joining us.
Hello, thank you for having me.
Now, this is a slight sequel to a book that you released a few years ago now called Moth. That was all about life and it was about evolution. Kind of remind us about that book before we talk about this book, if you can.
It was. So Moth really answers one of the big, big questions that children ask right from a very young age, which is, you know, how does life get here? How are there so many different types of plants and animals? And I realised that it was a brilliant story to explain this to children, explain the idea of natural selection. So how species change over time. You know, why don't we see dinosaurs around anymore? Why do we see all the animals that we do today? And that's the story of the peppered moth, which is a moth that still lives in the UK and in different parts of the world. And most peppered moths 150 years ago had pale wings, which are called speckled freckled wings, but occasionally a moth was born with entirely dark brown wings. And as their environment changed, the moths began to change too. So basically, as trees got covered in soot during the Industrial Revolution, the dark brown moths had more chance of surviving and having baby moths of their own. So gradually over time, more and more dark moths appeared in the population of moths. So that's really the basics of natural selection, and you can grasp that at a very young age. So that helps children to then go on to understand how evolution works and to understand all of the life that we see around us.
And now you're talking about the circle of life. Before we get into the real, like, the dark stuff that this book touches on a little bit, just tell us all about the circle of life as best as you can. I mean, we probably mostly know it from The Lion King. Tell us a bit more about it if you can.
I could do it without music. That's okay. So the circle of life, then I was thinking, okay, for the follow-up, I really want to again look at a really, really big question that children ask. And what they'll ask about, thinking of my own sons, you know, even walking across the school field on our school run, we often come across animals that have died. So you might kind of come across a pigeon that's maybe even been hunted by a fox during the night. And they would always ask, you know, start talking about what is death? What's going to happen now to that pigeon? So then I would always talk to them about the circle of life. And it basically is the idea that nature is one big recycling plant in a way, and everything that you see around you that's alive now will one day die. But those atoms, those particles that make it up, won't just disappear. They will all be recycled by nature into new life. So that's really the idea of the circle of life. It's a big recycling circle that keeps on going and going.
Now, there's quite a big question that's in the book, and I think it asks quite simply, doesn't it, why do we die?
Yeah, at the end of the book, I sort of look at, you know, why can't we live forever? And you sort of need more than one book to give the answer in its entirety. But it's basically that idea that life is always about regenerating itself. So you'll see that, you know, it tends to be older animals and older plants that will die. And by that point, they've sort of had their offspring, they've had their baby animals. In this book, fox, the mother fox, has had her baby cubs. So in that way, they've already passed on into new life. But then, of course, if things just died and just sort of stayed as they were, we'd soon be surrounded, you know, the nature would run out of materials for that new life. So nature has its way of breaking down those old dead animals and plants and recycling them into new life.
Now, you've described that in the book, obviously, with a fox, which is quite a stunning creature, isn't it? Is it this might be the most stupid question you've ever heard. Is it the same with maybe an animal that's not so pretty? Something like a slug. Like, when a slug dies, what is that doing? What is that giving to the soil that's then moving back and then it's coming to another creature in more life?
Yeah, so what the thing I suppose I'd love children to understand about life is that we're all made from the exact same building blocks. You know, I can basically tell you 13 elements that our own bodies are built from, and you'll see as you look at animals and as you look at plants that we're all made of the same stuff. So it doesn't matter so much what kind of animal is dying, as it's broken down through which is a very kind of curriculum word, but decomposition, as it's broken down, it's nourishing new life. So you're literally seeing other animals going and feeding on that, say your dead slug, and then that's obviously giving life to them. They're taking in, as they eat, those building blocks into their own bodies and using them to build their own bodies. And then as the slug slowly disappears into the soil, plants are taking those same building blocks and they're becoming all the new parts of the plants. They're helping trees grow bigger, helping you know, flowers to bloom. So it doesn't matter what your starting point is, you all feed into that circle of life, and every single living thing is connected in that way.
And then us as humans, we eat, some people eat meat, some people just eat plants, and then we're eating it, then we're digesting it, then it comes out of us, which then goes right back into the into the world and into the plants, which is eaten by animals sooner or later down the line. Exactly. Is that how it works?
Exactly. So we're lucky, being omnivores. We have a massive choice of what to eat. Unlike a fox, which basically has to hunt meat to eat, we can get by on a plant diet and be perfectly healthy. And luckily, we never have to eat slugs, so it's all good. And we're always being nourished by our food. Even if you're eating something like a carrot, say that is a dead plant, but that the all of the particles from that carrot are then being used to build your body, and your body is very clever at just taking exactly what it needs.
Now, the book has been illustrated. Some brilliant pictures in there. Stunning. Really bring it to life. Tell us more about how striking these pictures are and how you worked with the illustrator.
So the illustrator is called Daniel Gnaeus, and it's the same illustrator I worked with for Moth. And we don't actually work together face to face. Daniel lives in Athens in Greece, so we've never met in real life, but we do talk online. So I came up with the idea for wanting to do this story, and obviously I'd already done Moth, and then Daniel thought that was an idea he'd love to work on too. So I would write the text and then send it to the editor, who works at a publishing house called Bloomsbury. So the publishers, the people who put the books together and, you know, link up the author and the illustrator. And then they would sort of talk about it, and a designer would think, okay, how could this work on the page? And then all of those ideas would get sent to Daniel, and then he'd layer on all his ideas too. So by the time the book comes back to me with artwork to look at, it's got so many new things that I hadn't thought of, and it's just the best moment when you open it up and you see someone's taking all of your ideas and turn it into something even better, and it's just gorgeous artwork. So even though we're dealing with there is a sad part in the book where a fox dies, and Daniel has even made that part so beautiful and really kind of brought out that the beautiful aspects of the circle of life.
What's the next book that you're working on that you're going to come on and tell us all about? Is where do you move on? You've done evolution and life. You've done the story of death. What happens next?
Well, that's a challenge, isn't it? That's a challenge I'm going to have to try and take up. I'm working on a lot of different books at the moment, but I think the next big book that I would love to come and talk to you about is going to be a book answering loads of different amazing questions that children ask. So I'm busy collecting questions. I love nothing better than an impossible sounding question, and I love to answer them. So hopefully in a couple of years, I'll come back to talk to you about that one.
Amazing. Well, the current book is Fox. It's a Circle of Life story. It's absolutely brilliant. We love the author, Isabel Thomas. Thank you so much for chatting to us.
Thank you so much.
Now, this week's Dangerous Dan is all about the largest eagle in the world. The Harpy Eagle is one of the heaviest and most powerful birds on the planet. It's a huge predatory bird. It's found in South America, getting up towards Mexico as well. And it is massive. It's so massive, it actually looks a little bit like a person. Get online, look up the picture right now of the Harpy Eagle. It looks like a fully grown adult, like your mum or dad, who are wearing a bird costume for Halloween. Seriously, it's amazing. Now, they're dark grey. They've got feathers on their head that fan out and also grow massive when they feel threatened. Now, their talons, their claws, are about the same size as a grizzly bear's claw. They're huge. And they're no slouches either. They fly at about 50 miles an hour, swooping down, attacking, snatching prey with the talons. It's also hard to hide from it, because the Harpy Eagle can see something that's tiny, about 2 centimetres big from 200 metres away, which is proper needle in a haystack stuff. It's also quite patient as well. This beast doesn't go move too quickly. It's fine to sit around. It waits high in a tree for almost an entire day, 23 hours before attacking. And then when it does, it's absolutely deadly. When it hunts, it'll crush its food in one swoop, in one grab of its massive grizzly bear claws. That's why the Harpy Eagle absolutely gets a place on our Dangerous Dan list. Let's catch up with one of our favourite inventors on the show now, who's going to tell us all about some of the other greatest inventors there have been. This is Sir Sidney McSprocket.
Sir Sidney McSprocket's Great British Minds. Oh, hello, Sir Sidney McSprocket here. Now, I'm lucky to come from a fine line of inventors. My mother, in particular, was renowned for her musical badger brush. And that encouragement has meant that I'm not afraid to experiment. And I've always had very tidy hair. Now, remember, to be a great mind, if something goes well, that's tremendous. And when things go... less well. Well, you just try again and don't give up. Think of all the amazing creations that would never have seen the light of day if it wasn't for great minds courageously continuing to create, invent, and design. As we have seen, the Great Exhibition in London in 1851 was a great opportunity to celebrate great British minds. Folk came from all over the country, and indeed from across the world, to see the latest inventions. And one of the most popular exhibits was the pilot kite, designed by G.M. Gilbert. Gilbert, who came from Ealing in London, created a carriage that was drawn by kites. Rather large kites. He calculated that using kites around 5 meters wide could move a carriage containing 4 or 5 people. Well, at least on a windy day. Now, think of how inspiring that must have seemed in a time when the only non-horse-drawn vehicles were steam-powered. Our modern-day great British mind is not only inspiring, but has inspired people everywhere to be creative and fix the objects they use every day. Let me introduce Jane Galquanti from Ireland. Jane is the inventor of Sugru, an innovative, moldable glue that sticks to almost anything and turns into strong, flexible rubber overnight. It can form a strong bond with a huge range of different materials, including aluminium, steel, ceramics, glass, wood, and other materials, including some plastics and rubber. It was invented for people looking to not only repair, but improve the things they use every day. Fixing things is very important if we want to use fewer of the Earth's resources. But Jane also wanted people to enjoy the achievement of fixing things and to use Sugru to make changes to gadgets and objects, even toys, to make them work better for themselves. From making modifications to customized handles on sports equipment, to attaching watches onto wheelchairs, and even adding shock-absorbing bumpers to digital gadgets so children can safely use them without worrying about damage. It's all about feeling empowered to make changes yourself so you and the people around you can use things in a way that works for you. With a Fixer's Manifesto, Jane and the Sugru community are really inspiring others to save resources by extending the life of objects and make changes to make objects work better for them. A great British mind indeed. And the terrific thing is you can be a fixer too. Especially if you're the sort of person who doesn't give up easily and who keeps trying. And talking of trying, I'm having one last go at this little creation here. It's a turbo fan to dry the dishes. Capable of speeds in excess of 400 miles an hour. No more drying the pots for me. Oh, mostly as there are no pots now. Back to the drawing board. Never give up. Patty bye for now.
Sir Sidney McSprocket's Great British Minds. With support from the Royal Commission 1851. Find out more at funkidslive.com/McSprocket.
Now it's time for this week's Science in the News. Some of the UK's favourite snacks are failing the environment. crisps, chocolate and cheese products, they have the worst non-recyclable packaging, according to a study by Which Magazine, a consumer group. They say that Cadbury, Babybel and Pringles have all been classed as notoriously hard to recycle. Also, NASA have outlined a £22 billion plan to put the first woman on the moon by 2024. As part of the Artemis program, NASA will put the first humans back on the moon since 1972. The astronauts, a man and a woman, they'll travel in a capsule called Orion, which will be launched from a rocket called the SLS. And finally, some sad news. Almost 400 whales have died after being stranded on an Australian beach. It happened in Tasmania. Now, no one really knows why this happens, but the whales moved to the beach and they couldn't break free from the sand. And eventually they lost their lives on the island's west coast. And that is it for this week's Fun Kids Science Weekly. Thank you so much for listening to, officially, did you hear this earlier on? We won an award given out by some strange space creature. We won an award for the greatest podcast in the history of the universe, which I think is pretty good going, don't you? I bet you're pleased that you listen. Thank you for listening. As always, if you've got a science question that you want answered on the show, you need to leave it for me as a review over on Apple Podcasts. While you're there, it's one of the best places that you can hear so many brilliant science series that we make. They're on there, they're on Spotify, Google, wherever you get your podcasts. You can find them on the free Fun Kids app as well, and at funkidslive.com. And Fun Kids are a children's radio station from the UK. You can hear us all around the country on your DAB digital radio, on that free Fun Kids app, and at funkidslive.com.